In a previous video, we looked at how to take an existing character and turn it into an asset. Now, suppose we were to create a scene from scratch. We have a modeler who has a bunch of different ideas for how the assets will look, an animator who's already got an idea for how they'll move, and maybe even a programmer who's waiting to plug the assets into an interactive environment. How can we plan our scene so that all these different aspects will mesh? Asset templates allow you to outline a set of expectations for what an asset can do. With a template, you can fully plan out the attributes and behaviors of an asset before you even create the geometry. It also allows you to ensure compatibility between scene objects by standardizing their inputs and outputs. Here we have a simple character proxy. Let's create a template from it that will define our future characters. As you can see, we've already placed our proxy in an asset and published the appropriate controls. If you need more information on how to create assets and publish attributes, check out our previous video on creating a character asset. Now let's make the template itself. First, open the asset editor. This is our one-stop shop for everything assets related. In the left panel, select the asset and click the pin icon. This shows us all the proxy's published attributes in the right panel. Notice that all the arrows in the right panel are red. This indicates that these are published attributes that do not yet belong to a template. The italicized words next to them represent the actual attributes within the asset that are bound to these names. Think of these as a link between the published name and the attribute, so that when you change one value, the other changes as well. Now let's save our template. When Maya saves a template from an existing asset, it records all the published attributes and saves them out as an XML file. Let's also create a binding set. A binding set records the names of the actual node attributes within the asset and adds them to our template file. We'll see why this is important in a few moments. Notice that all the red arrows turn green to indicate that they now belong to a template. All right, now we're ready to hand this template off to our modeling, animation, and programming departments. With this, our modeler will know what attributes the rig requires, while the animator and programmer will know the exact names and functions of the various attributes they'll have at their disposal. Meet Ethan, one of the final characters for our scene. Notice that Ethan is not contained in an asset. However, if we look at the various character controls, you can see that they're named identically to those of our proxy. Let's apply our template. Select Ethan's components in the outliner and create an asset for him. Now in the asset editor, pin the Ethan asset and assign a new template. In the assign options, notice that the auto bind option is enabled. AutoBind is going to allow Maya to automatically publish and bind all of Ethan's attributes exactly the same way that the proxy's attributes were published and bound. This is possible because Ethan's control nodes are named identically to our proxy and because we created a binding set. Now just select the robot template file and Maya handles the rest. Notice that in the right panel, that all of Ethan's attributes are automatically published and show up with green arrows. Great! Just like that, we're done with our Ethan asset. Now let's see what our animator's been up to. It looks like our animator's given us a quick little dancing animation. Let's import our new and improved Ethan and see what it looks like on him. To transfer the animation over, we won't need to use anything as complex as an animation retargeter. Instead, we're just going to transfer the attribute values directly over from the proxy to Ethan. We can do this because we know from the template that both assets have identical published attribute names. Now we're going to transfer the proxy's attribute values over the entire timeline, so in the transferred attribute values options, turn on both values and in connections. Also, let's share the animation between the proxy and Ethan so that we can compare them side by side. Now if we move the proxy over, you can see the animation is transferred without any problems. Now if you recall, we used Autobind to map Ethan's node attributes to our template's published attribute names. This is well and good for applying to a character that just happens to have matching node and attribute names, but what about the much more likely scenario where our modeler used his own naming convention? Furthermore, what if the controls didn't match up in such a neat one-to-one manner? Well, even in cases like these, we can still use this template, but we'd have to bind our attributes manually. Let's take a look at our second robot, Emmett. You'll notice that, once again, this character is not yet contained in an asset. Also, if we look at his various controls, the naming convention is completely different from our binding set. Just like Ethan, we need to first create an asset for Emmett, then open the asset editor and assign a new template. Unlike Ethan, this time we'll have to turn off Autobind because we already know the control curves of Emmett don't match the names of those on Ethan. We also want to turn off the creation of stand-in attributes since we'll be binding our attributes manually. Now, the template is applied to Emmett, but the right panel appears empty. If we expand the unbound section, we'll find all our published names from the template. Notice how no arrows appear to the left of these names, and no italicized attributes appear to the right. This is because we have yet to bind these published names to anything on Emmett's body. In Ethan's case, this was handled automatically, but in this case, these published names will be our roadmap, showing us all the attributes that we need to publish manually to make Emmett fully comply with our template. Let's start by binding attributes on Emmett's body with these published names, starting with his center of gravity. In the left column, expand the asset until you find the COG curve. If it's not already activated, turn on the attribute display. Now view the attributes and find the translation. In the right column, find the COG translate published name and click the bind button next to it. The COG translation published names move from the unpublished section to the published section. While we could have also bound the X, Y, and Z attributes individually, binding the general translate attribute will handle all the translations at once in cases where we need all three. Also notice that just like in Ethan, the small green arrow icon appears, as well as the italicized node attributes. We've now mapped the center of gravity translation required by the template to the appropriate control curve on Emmett. The bound attributes allow us to modify the center of gravity's translation in the attribute editor and channel box. You can go ahead and map the COG rotate the same way. If you want to interact with the COG control with your mouse, you'll also need to publish the COG node itself. Templates don't record published nodes. Now that we've done the body, we can fill the rest of the template in the same way, binding shoulders to shoulders, knees to knees, ankles to ankles, and so on. However, you may notice an interesting problem when attempting to bind the elbows or waist. If we zoom in and take a look at one of Emmett's elbows, we can see that unlike Ethan's, it's actually composed of three pieces, each of which only rotates in a single direction. To make matters more complicated, the local rotation axes don't quite match up with the convention we've used for the shoulder and wrist. For example, you can see here that the roll of the elbow is an X rotation, whereas the roll of the shoulder or wrist is a Y rotation. Thankfully, with a little asset ingenuity, this will actually be a pretty simple problem to solve. Return to the asset editor and select the L elbow FK roll anim curve in the left panel. Now find its rotate X attribute and bind it to the template's left elbow FK rotate Y attribute. We're only going to publish this one attribute in this particular control. Now select the L elbow FK pitch anim curve, which corresponds to the arm's bend. Bind its rotate Y attribute to the published left elbow FK rotate X attribute. As you've probably guessed by now, we'll finish by selecting the L elbow FK yaw anim curve and binding its Z rotation to the remaining left elbow FK rotate Z attribute. Great, now you've completed the elbow binding. In essence, Assets has allowed us to bind one attribute from three different objects on Emmet to three attributes on one object of our template. Now you can do the same thing with the other elbow and the waist. Once you've finished the bind process, there should only be three things left in the unbound section: waist rotate, left elbow FK rotate, and right elbow FK rotate. These are left over because of the single attribute bindings we did on the elbows and waist, and it's fine to leave them here for that reason. Congratulations, your template is now fulfilled. This means that Emmet is now fully compatible with Ethan. You can transfer the animation to Emmet as a test. You can now continue this pattern using your template to build an army of interchangeable characters, while your animators continue to animate scenes using nothing but the proxy.